What up, everyone? Today we're doing Super Mario Brothers 3. I wasn't sure if I was actually going to record today, but some things on YouTube compelled me to make this video. So let's just see where it takes us. Doing things a little differently today. Let me go ahead and start my timer for 19 minutes. Doing things a little bit differently today because usually I just talk about whatever's on the top of my head. But today, I'm actually going to try to work with a list of topics. Today it's just a small list. It's three topics. Let's see if that's how that does for me. Because last time I felt like I really didn't have enough to talk about, which happens sometimes because I'm socially awkward. But you know what you're gonna do. So it's why sometimes I'm going to have a wealth of topics. Other times I'm going to struggle to come up with more than one. But we'll see how it does today. Go and fire up the game. Of course, it's not working. It was working when I tested it out. Really? Okay. Ah, the joys of nostalgic gaming. Okay. Most people consider this to be the game that forever changed the history of gaming, but you know, there's several Super Mario games you can say about that. You can make a very strong case that the original Super Mario Brothers changed the face of gaming because it did. Anyone who argues that is obviously not in the know as far as things go. Atari did their damnedest to destroy the video game industry, and Super Mario Brothers pretty much saved it. You know, gaming was still a somewhat safe bet as far as the arcade machines goes. Because people go out and you have a captive audience, they're waiting for their food in a pizza parlor or whatever, and there's your entertainment. Donkey Kong is going to keep you occupied while you're waiting for your pepperoni calzone and your large Diet Coke. But, you know, That's different from the home console market that Atari basically crashed in 1984, I believe, which was the year I was born. So, it wasn't a bad year all around, but it was a pretty bad year for video games. Anyway, a strong argument can be made that Super Mario Brothers saved the video game console market. Oh god! Man, that's embarrassing. I haven't done that since I was like 5. I always get up there. But, you know, I'm good in other ways than I wasn't as a kid, so it balances out. I just need to play more video games. I've gotten soft, especially by playing all these modern bullshit games. Where, you know, if you die 5 times in a row, the game gives you an option to skip this part. It's like, no! Don't give you the option to skip! Make the player overcome the challenge, as long as it's a reasonable challenge. Don't spoon-feed the gamer. Don't baby them. You know, good lord, Nintendo. Remember when you used to have integrity back in these days? Let's see. Yes, it's 1-3 that has the first whistle. Whistle. And it's the fortress that has the other whistle. Now I'm making that lame joke. I can't help it. Even though it's lame, I still make it. Because it's just a fun joke saying whistle or Whitney or cool whip. You know, what you gonna do? A good joke is a good joke even if it's written or performed by a douchebag. But, you know, I don't need to get too honest with my feelings here. Seth MacFarlane is a douchebag. You know, he makes some decent cartoons from time to time, but as a person, he's a total asshole. Funny thing is, I actually know someone who thinks the opposite. He doesn't like his cartoons, but he likes his politics. I mean, you know, as far as Seth MacFarlane goes, when it comes to getting political, there has to be a better way to do it than what he does. It's just so, as I said before, douchebaggy. You know, I say he has a 50-50 record as far as his cartoons go. Like, all of his series have their very good episodes and their very, very bad episodes. Like, for instance, in my humble but accurate opinion, Family Guy started off good, and then it got really, really, really bad for a while, and then it started to get good again. You know, the good doesn't erase all the bad, though, so it's kind of hard to get that nasty taste out of your mouth, that nasty Family Guy taste out of your mouth. Oh, man, that sounds worse than what I meant for it to sound like. Okay, so I need to make sure that... Wait, I need to leave. Where do I get to leave? Not that way. Okay. But as I was saying, you know, there just has to be a better way for him to get his point across than the way he does it. It's like, you know, he has this way of acting like anyone who disagrees with him is a total moron or, you know, corrupt or, you know, just not in the right. It's like, if you disagree with Seth MacFarlane, you're a terrible person. That's just kind of the way it comes across to me. To me. Desert, water, what is four? Isn't four giant land? Seven's ice, six is, seven is, pipe land, six is ice, five. Oh well, doesn't matter. I'm going to skip to 8 anyway. This seems like a good place to start my first topic. I dropped my controller. Man, come on, Trey, bring up the energy level just a little bit. All right. Ready, fire, aim. Wait, doesn't he mean ready, aim, fire? No, I mean ready, fire, aim. Shoot to kill. Man, this level's no joke. I need to stop acting like it is. Ready, fire, aim. It's words to live by. It's a philosophy that's changed my artistic life. It's what's made the difference between me getting those things done and not getting those things done. See, most would argue that, you know, well, I thought it was ready, aim, fire. But the thing is, as one of my role models, Steve Pavlina, has said, ready, aim, fire often ends up turning into ready, aim, 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 and fire never comes. And, you know, another word for it is analysis paralysis. You get paralyzed by analyzing. Come on, man. That was a hit for me. So, you know, you get paralyzed by analyzing your situation. You, in the attempt to be perfect, you continue strategizing and tweaking your strategy and, you know, just reading up on everything or analyzing everything that you never actually pull the trigger and get to that point where you're actually doing something, where you're taking action. So you're essentially paralyzed by your analysis paralysis. And it's such an awesome concept because, you know, I've been guilty of that so many times. It's like I've sabotaged myself by my own perfection. That's why, you know, I chose to try to stop identifying as a perfectionist, because it got me nowhere. Perfectionism got me nowhere. So, you know, it's like, instead, I want to see myself as someone with high standards. And, not necessarily high in the sense that everything I put out has to be amazing, but that I'm always, you know, increasing my standards. I'm always, you know, moving forward instead of backwards or moving in place. So, as with this show, Gossip and Games, you know, I told myself, just put it out. Make improvements along the way, but just get it out there. No more analysis paralysis. You know how to do this. You are more than capable of putting together a series like this. You know, you have the time, you have the knowledge, you have the expertise, you have the freaking video games, man. Just do it. Stop making excuses and just do it. So, that's kind of what I told myself. It's like, you know, get this out there. You know, do the damn thing. You know, make improvements as you go, absolutely. But, you know, keep them coming. Stay on top of it. Stop wasting your life thinking about the things that you want to do. Do those things. That took me pretty far back. So, you know, it's just that simple. Ready, fire, aim. You know, you get ready and you pull the trigger. You fire. You shoot to kill. And then you see what works and what doesn't, and then you aim. You alter your strategy just slightly so you can get yourself where you need to be without sacrificing the production aspect, without getting it out, without not getting it out. I'm gonna focus on the game here for just a minute, because I would like to get past this level. It'll be pretty embarrassing if I shoot this whole thing and I'm on the same level every time. Because I have at least two more topics to discuss. Maybe I'll come up with something else along the way. Ugh! P-wing or something, man. This is embarrassing. Why did I choose to come to World 8 after being out of practice? Time to bring my A game. Or at least my C-plus game. C-plus, man. That was obviously C-minus. C-plus. Balls everywhere. Start over. So this time, let's go for Waterworld. So, I've kind of gotten the itch to go back to Disney World. It happened quicker than I thought. I'm recording this in, what month is this? This is September of 2015. So, it's been 2 years since I've been to Disney World. Oh my god, it's been that long? Because I went in September of 2013. It was, my wedding anniversary falls in September, so this was just something extra special to do for the wedding anniversary. So, that was pretty cool. I thought I'd be burned out on Disney World for at least like 4 to 5 years, but yeah, I'm kind of ready to go back. If you know anything about me, you know that my technique for photography is based on the idea that I believe in the diamond in the rough theory, that you can take up to 100 pictures and maybe only one of them is going to come out the way you want it to. But I would rather take 200 pictures and get 2 good pictures out of it than to just take 2 or 3 pictures and hope that they turn out good. But that's just my OCD coming out, probably. By the way, I'm not really OCD, but that's the way I describe myself sometimes because of my drive to do things. Like, you know, at work, I use that term to describe myself all the time. It's like I expect a certain standard when I work from myself. And I will work my fingers to the bone until that standard is realized. You know, regardless of whether it's practical to do or not. It's, you know, I'm sure in some lights it's my strength, and I'm sure in other lights it's my weakness. But, I took, you know, at least 3,000 pictures while I was in Orlando, and we were only there a few days. We were there at either 4 or 5 days, but, you know, that's still a lot of pictures per day if you do the math. I'm not going to do the math right now, so I'll just let it scroll down here. Is that alright? Okay. Let's get that whistle. But, I decided to actually take my old photographs that I took down in Orlando, down in Disney World, and I decided to make an article series out of them, and I do hope that I can get these articles to take off in the way that I want to. And I'd like to go back to Orlando and do some more stuff. I'd like to, you know, check out some of the local businesses. I want to do some more Disney World and Orlando studio stuff, obviously. You know, I just want to produce the content that you, the viewer, wants to see from down there. You know, you want to know what's going down in Orlando? I mean, or anywhere else for that matter. I'll keep you informed. I'll let you know what, you know, what's up. But, I need you, the viewer, to get behind me on this. You know, I need you to, you know, leave comments. I need you to check these articles out, on social media, you know, like, subscribe, whatever you need to do. And I'll return the favor. I will produce some content for you that you will want to get behind, that you want to know what's going on in such and such neighborhood. You want to know where to eat. You want to know. So, I actually forgot to sync this video up. Go ahead and just start and stop again. Okay, so let's sync up real quick. shot is framed properly. Got that green bottle representing. Bottle makes it green. But you know, I swear, the Jaeger tastes like purple to me. Set an alarm. Set it for 18 minutes. Okay. So earlier, I was talking about my OCD when I'm at work, you know, whatever. Is this a frog suit? It's not. But I will take firepower, which, you know, fireballs while you're underwater. Duh. Of course it makes sense. But, I was talking about the way I work earlier. That was nice while it lasted. About how I have certain standards that have to be met, and or I will work until they are met. Like, you know, that's the same way I approach this series, just on a much larger scale. You know, if I'm like at work or whatever, if I expect a certain level of, say, cleanliness in the kitchen, I can make that happen in a matter of minutes, or worst case scenario, in an hour or two. But, as far as standards go for video production, that's a little bit trickier. Yeah, video production's a little bit slower paced than, food service. If I was to impose the exact same standards on my videos as I do, in the kitchen, I would never get a video out. They would always constantly be, you know, on the back burner. They would always be, you know, modified. They would be in post-production hell, basically. Just always getting, you know, I'm not happy. This has to be perfect. I can realize those 99% standards. So, I kind of view myself as the Walter White of my own reality. The, you know, the purity has to be there. 99 point whatever percent. It has to be pure. So my standards have to be met 99 point whatever percent. Now the thing about it is that, as I said, you know, that's a little bit more difficult to realize when media is concerned. Sometimes it takes a little bit of time to meet those standards. You know, I would rather have substandard work out there if it means I'm going to eventually get to where my standards are. As far as my standards go for Gossip and Games, they're getting closer. I don't want to assign a number value, but, you know, I wouldn't say it's in the 90% range yet. So, I wouldn't say it's too far away from 90%. Ugh! Because in the earlier episodes, let me see, what were my main issues? My first issue was that, the games have to be played on a real television. Because I did Super Mario Kart. I was just checking the computer, making sure it was still recording. I did Super Mario Kart first, but I connected the Super Nintendo straight to the computer. That was a nightmare. Because what ended up happening was, there was just a slight delay. And I spent literally at least half of the video session trying to get used to that half second delay. I mean, it didn't help either that I'm used to playing Mario Kart 8, and the controls are just slightly different on Mario Kart 8 compared to Super Mario Kart. So the first thing that I changed is, like, you know, it has to be played on a real TV. I can't compromise on that. It's just, the experience is not authentic enough. It's fake. It's like, you know, when you're trying to achieve nostalgia, but it just falls short, like, severely. And that's what it was like when I, really, man? I always found that to be very gruesome as a kid, you know, but, you know how some people are into that boar shit? Water, so let's try the frog suit. Oh yeah, that was brilliant. You know how some people are into that boar shit? Like they get, you know, the idea of getting eaten turns them on. It's like, I'm sure that I can relate to that a little bit, but only in the sense that I think these people went through like the same phobias and fears that I did as a child. Like the stories where the little kids always get eaten in the end, those were the ones that freaked me out the most. Like, some versions of Hansel and Gretel, it's a cautionary tale, and they don't get away. You know, or the Gingerbread Man. You know, the Gingerbread Man always kind of freaked me out for that reason, because in some versions of the story, he doesn't get away, he gets eaten. So, that always kind of freaked me out as a kid. In fact, one of my oldest memories is of me having a nightmare about getting eaten. So I was probably 3 or 4, late 3s, early 4, maybe mid 4, when this happened. But I still remember it very vividly. Yeah, I know what's up. I don't really, I just know that those two often match. Disney World, man, though. Can't wait to go back. Like, you know, the thing about Disney World is I strongly believe in not having an itinerary. I know that's how a lot of people tackle it. Those people are, unfortunately, a little short-sighted. And I hate to say that, but they are. Because, you know how long you would have to stay at Disney World in order to do everything, or even to do everything worth doing? I mean, you would have to be there, like, probably a month. And this would be a very intense month. This wouldn't be no laid-back month. This would be, like, doing stuff every day type of month. You know, some days would obviously be more intense than others, but, you know, I digress at this point. You know, no itinerary. My strategy for Disney World was, I wanted to make a list of, absolutely must-dos, and I kept this list very, very short. Like, 5 or less short. Like, absolutely must-dos, let me see if I can remember, you know. I won't remember some of them because there's just the sheer magnitude of the stuff, but the Polynesian, visiting the Polynesian was absolutely must do. The Kona Cafe at the Polynesian was an absolute must do. I think Space Mountain was an absolute must do. Dole Whip was an absolutely must do. The turkey leg was an absolutely must-do. The Mickey Mouse ice cream, the Mickey Mouse head ice cream sandwich was an absolute must-do. You know, it's basically a Klondike bar, but it's like, to me, it's like Disney World in ice cream form. It's so simple, but it works. So, I mean, I can't think of many other absolute must-dos. Because, you know, like I said, 5 or less. I don't know how many that was. That was probably 5. It might have been 6. You know, whatever. It wasn't an exact number. And it's been 2 years since I've been there, so I don't remember exactly what conclusions I came to. But then there was a whole bunch of, do if it's convenient. Or if the opportunity shows up. Like, basically everything else there was on this list. And then there was the list of do if the opportunity shows itself. like, a lot of the World Showcase was on there. Like, I really wanted to, check out the Cava del Tequila. Easy for me to say, right? And I actually found that place to be incredibly overrated. Like, it was good, but only in the sense that a high-end Tex-Mex place is good. You know, there's only so far up the ladder it can go. You know, Tex-Mex, the best Tex-Mex place doesn't hold a candle compared to an average Mexican place. And there's a strong distinction there. You know what a Mexican place is? A Mexican place is a place that Mexicans go to. It's just that simple, you know, and a real Japanese place is a place that Japanese people go to, etc., etc. You know, if the people represent from that particular culture, if they actually go there, not just employees there, you know, or friends of employees, but if actual, like, Mexicans go to a Mexican restaurant, then you can probably be reassured that it is actually Mexican and not just Tex-Mex. You know, the idealist will say that, well, isn't food universal? Is there really such a thing as authentic Mexican food? Because, you know, that we draw inspiration from other cultures. You know, not Italians aren't the only people to use noodles, for example. And noodles are all over, especially in Asia. So, you know, they say it's hard to say what is definitively Mexican and what would be definitively Tex-Mex. And my retort to that would be that if you have to ask, then you probably haven't experienced it. Like, I love authentic Mexican food. And the sadness is, if you don't live in a city, you probably don't even know what I'm talking about when I say authentic Mexican. You know, it's authentic Mexican food is, you know, the blunt way of saying is it's peasant food. But please understand that when I say peasant food, I mean it as a sign of endearment. I say the same thing about a good Cuban sandwich. And you will not catch me on the East Coast without having a Cuban sandwich at least once. Unless I am literally just driving through for like, and not stopping, I am going to get me a Cuban sandwich. So for me to call it a peasant food is not a bad thing at all. I represent blue collar. That is what I am. I am not some white collar lazy asshole who gets paid $1 million to complain. You know, I may one day become a millionaire and I may not, but I will represent the blue collar worker for my entire life. Because that's me, that's my family, that's my people, that's my culture. We work for a living. We were not put on this planet just to find ways to be lazy. As I say this while playing a video game and trying to get people to take it seriously. So yes, the irony is not lost on me in that sense. This has been a good session. So, I'm going ahead and, bring that conversation, that topic to a close, because I'm approaching the 40-minute mark, I believe. And the longer this goes, the more work it involves for me to edit. I also have a serious thing to discuss. I have 3 minutes, so I'm gonna go ahead and just stop it here so I don't get interrupted. Okay, we're back. Go ahead and start the timer again. So, I'm a big fan of YouTube. I'm a big fan of the YouTube community. And, a lot of people see YouTube as a waste of time, and, I disagree. I think YouTube is part of the future. I think YouTube is an evolution of the human species' interactions with each other, if that makes sense. I see the same thing in YouTube that I saw in the blogosphere back, around 2010 and before. The blogosphere was the beginnings of a new progression in the human species. It is us making one step closer to the divine. It is humankind evolving to the next level. And I don't really know how else to describe it except that way. See, as what I believe myself to be, a light worker, I see these things. It's a gift, but it can also be viewed as a curse. I see evolution unfold before my eyes. Let's see if I can remember any of this. Here? Yes. I didn't see one of those. Mushroom. Oh, damn. Okay. I see YouTube as being a very relevant thing in today's culture, in the same way that Twitter is a very relevant thing in today's culture, and some people get it, and some people don't. I get it. I see the significance of things like YouTube and Twitter. I always dreamed of the day when I could basically have my own TV show, when I could have my own network, where I had the capabilities of realizing these dreams of mine, to have an audience, to express myself, and for people to listen. I thought these were pipe dreams. I thought that I would have to, get signed to a multi-million-dollar contract or something in order for these things to happen. I didn't think the average person would be able to do these things in the year 2015 or 2010 or even earlier than that. 2006 to be precise is when I believe YouTube first became a thing. Oh man, I hate this level. But I didn't think these things were gonna happen. So, Twitter's a whole nother topic. I won't get into that either. It just has to do with me believing, that journalism is corrupt and Twitter has taking being informed to the common person. But YouTube has leveled the playing field as far as media is concerned, particularly video. Although YouTube does its part to spread awareness about other forms of media, such as music and photography. So, I try to stay informed as to what's going on YouTube. The thing is, you know, the most popular of YouTube personalities, I'm not a big fan of, for the most part. I can see why some of these popular YouTube personalities got popular, but they don't appeal to me. Like, take for example, PewDiePie. Yeah, I enjoy his stuff from time to time, but I can only take him in small amounts because he reminds me of everything that's wrong with modern society. But nothing against the guy, he seems like a nice guy. It's just the fact that what he does generates the most publicity on YouTube. That's a pretty prime example of what's wrong with society in this day and age. Out of this level. Man, tired of getting eaten. So, I'm aware of people like Matthew Santoro. I know that he exists. I know what he does. I know, his contribution to existing. Let me just say right off the bat that I'm not at all a fan of his work. I find his work to be annoying on a personal level. Because I really wanted to like the guy. But I think he has a very irreverent taste of sense of humor, and I only say that because I'm not a prude. I'm not somebody who believes in censorship. I believe that there's an audience for your brand, for your personality. Go get yours. I just happen to find some of his jokes to be in poor taste. And if the joke is funny, if it can be in poor taste and be funny, that's one thing. But that's not the impression I got of Matthew Santoro. It's like, he thinks he's funny, and because he thinks he's funny, people with no sense of humor is going to think he's funny. But that's just my opinion. And full disclosure, I haven't watched all of his videos. I've only watched a handful, so maybe I can give him a second chance. But I'm just not a fan of his sensational crack.com swiped headlines. 9 amazing things that actually exist. That whole type of thing. It's just like the type of stuff you see on Cracked, and just like Cracked, it's ignorance disguised as intellectualism. And that's my problem with Cracked, and it's my problem with Matthew Santoro, though, too. It's like, you try to present yourself as being an intellectual, like someone who thinks about things, but you prove yourself to not be that. But you fool the people who actually need the guidance from intellectuals, who actually think things through. I'm concerned that I'm not coming across the way that I want to. I'm not trying to be against Matthew Santoro in this incident. The incident in question is what is her name? Let me look it up real quick. Nicole Arbour. So Nicole Arbour put out a video on YouTube. As of this recording, which I'm going to try to get this out as quickly as possible, as of this recording, it was 6 days ago. So I watched it and I couldn't even get through the whole thing. I tried my damnedest, but the level of ditzy ignorance just kind of got to me. And just for the record, I can kind of see how her and Matthew Santoro hooked up. They both have that same sense of humor. And that's all I'm going to say about that. Because I want to focus on Nicole Arbour. I've known girls like her. Girls like her are bad news. Fuck. Keep pressing start thinking it's gonna get me through that. Girls like her are bad news. There's one thing I can't stand, and at this point in my life, I'm trying to become more tolerant of other people. I'm trying to become a happier person as opposed to someone who's angry all the time. But this is some work, because if there's one thing I can't stand, it's a stupid person who thinks they're a smart person. I can deal with ignorance and stupidity. It doesn't bother me. What bothers me is a stupid person that thinks they're a smart person. I've known people like that my whole life, and it's always just grinding my gears. I wish it didn't. But, you know, this Nicole Arbour strikes me as someone who is a stupid person that thinks she's smart. You know, that's just my first impression. I could be wrong. But, I came across this story based upon a video that my main man Dame Drops did. So he brought it to my light, brought it to my attention, and the thing is, I was familiar with a lot of these names. I'd never heard of Nicole Arbour, but in my defense, I don't watch videos like hers. You know, she seems to be a carbon copy of what's her name? Karen Alloy, that I used to follow, that I've always liked, because she actually, with her, it was an interesting juxtaposition, because she came across as ditzy, but she was actually quite intelligent and very down to earth. So, Nicole Arbour comes across as somebody who's trying to be Karen Alloy. And she can't pull it off. It's like I like to say about female artists, pop artists. You're no Alanis. It's like Taylor Swift. I like Taylor Swift when she's doing, happy music. I don't like her when she's angry. She's no Alanis. And that's what I have to say about Nicole Arbour. You're no Alanis, or in this case, you're no Karen. Hello? Hi. Just doing some PC work before I go out and mow the lawn. You alright? Okay. Okay. Okay, so what needs to get done tonight? I mean, is there anything that has to get done tonight, or are we good to chill? Cool. Alright, we should. Okay. Is that a good thing? Yeah, I got that. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Okay. Okay. Cool. It was nice to hear from you. All right, well, I'll talk to you later, all right? Love you, too. Bye. See how much time we have. 4 minutes left. So Nicole Arbour made this video shaming fat people and being unapologetic about it. I'm not going to get into the details of every little thing she said because it's not worth it. You know, I'm not going to validate thoughts from pseudo-intelligent, ignorant people. But I will respond to a few of the general accusation that she made, which, correct me if I'm wrong, but the gist of what she said is that fat people have no reason to feel sympathy, that they should be shamed, and because it's for the greater good. If fat shaming leads to them getting their life turned around and their health improved, then fat shaming is ultimately a good thing. So correct me if I'm wrong, Nicole, if that's not what you meant, but that's the gist of what I got. And this is a test. This is a nice little test of for me to remain calm, because that's my challenge right now in life. Now, I've always had a temper, and I recognize that it's something that's always held me back. And, you know, right now it's the main thing that's holding me back from continued success that I, you know, want in my professional and personal life. So I need to get that under control. But this is a test, because Nicole's remarks pissed me off on a personal level. I happen to have, you know, plus size people in my life, and they mean a lot to me, and I don't appreciate the way that she has talked about them, lumping them in with, you know, everyone else, because the only reason that someone would be overweight is because they don't eat and exercise. That's it. That's the only thing that would cause a person to not be healthy, is because of their own shortcomings. It has nothing to do with genetics. It has nothing to do with past trauma, because people eat to find comfort in an otherwise cold and calloused world. It has nothing to do with that. It's only because they were born with the potential to be a skinny, petite, ditzy blonde girl like you. Because everything's equal. Yeah, I knew this was gonna piss me off. Look, in a lot of cases, yes, it is the overweight person does bring it upon himself. I agree with you. Damn it, I ran out of time. Okay, we're back. So yeah, I'm a little bit annoyed by these remarks. If you're wondering why I'm choosing frog suit, it's because that's going to give me 2 hit points as opposed to 1. That was probably a waste. Well, maybe not. Whoops. So yeah, Nicole Arbour is definitely someone who thinks she's intelligent, but she's actually not. I don't know if it's a Canadian thing, but, you know, it's the same impression I get from Matthew Santoro, so I can see why they got together. But, you know, there's also been allegations of abuse by, let's see, let me make sure I got my facts straight on this, because, you know, I just heard about this today, and I watched a few YouTube videos, so apparently Matthew Santoro, which I already knew this, is a close friend of Rob Dyke. Now, Rob Dyke does, he kind of does this interesting thing. He's this morbid looking dude with dark facial hair and dark hair. And he does the comedy and tragedy. Like, he does Why Would You Put That on the Internet, which is supposed to be funny. Emphasis on supposed to be. And then he does the Twisted Tin and all those other series that he does where he focuses on the macabre and the evils of humanity. That, I think he does pretty well. The humor, how do I say this without being a jerk? I don't think that Rob Dyke is cut out for humor. I think he pretends to understand humor, but I don't think he actually understands it. That's nothing against him. He does choice video work. He does choice content. He's a master at what he does. I think he's easily in a league above Matthew Santoro, but Matthew Santoro, I think, is the more popular of the two, which that's YouTube and that's modern society for you. But apparently, Rob Dyke explained a story that Matthew Santoro told to him. And I'm not sure if Rob had the authority to tell this story. I hope that he did. Because, these type of things, if they're told in confidence amongst friends, they should stay that way unless, circumstances, unless they agree that it can be made public. So I hope that that's what Rob did. But apparently, Rob told a story about Matt's relationship with Nicole Arbour. And long story short, it turned out to be a allegedly manipulative, and abusive relationship with physical violence involved on her part and intimidation and suicide threats. It's like, suicide is not something to be taken lightly. Suicide is a very serious thing, and anyone who would take it lightly, that's a whole nother subject altogether. I happen to have lost a close personal friend of mine to suicide. I believe it was suicide. And, because suicide was something that he often joked about. And it's become a sensitive subject to me, and there's plenty of people out there who have suffered more personal losses and more tragedy based on suicide. So I'm not going to pretend to be the poster boy for suicide damage, because I'm not. But it's not something that you take lightly. It's not something that you threaten just because you're a little emo bitch that doesn't know how to deal with people and has a meltdown whenever things don't go your way. Allegedly. I don't know for a fact that these things are true. What I do know for a fact is that Nicole Arbour is a pretty... If her video, Dear Fat People, can be taken into account, she's a pretty lousy human being. There's all kinds of reasons why someone would be overweight. And you know what? People are self-destructive in numerous ways. In this country, we have a right to be self-destructive. And so many forms of self-destruction are acceptable. But there are certain people, and they're always skinny bitches and skinny people, skinny guys, that have an issue with overweight people. They think just because they hit the genetic lottery, they can't gain weight, that it's a personal slight towards them if they have to even look at someone overweight. And this Nicole Arbour strikes me as someone like that. Someone so intolerant that they can't even look at someone different than them. These idiot people, these ignorant motherfuckers. They make a correlation, and they think that it's, intelligent, that, them being overweight affects me. No, it doesn't. If it affects you, that's a sign of an entirely different problem. I don't even know what to say. This bitch really, bothers me. Do I personally believe that she was in a abusive relationship with Matthew Santoro? It sounds plausible to me. Because just viewing her video, dear fat people, I learned a lot about her. I learned that I never want to allow her into my reality ever again. I can't stand people like that. So, let me just summarize this, because this has gone on long enough. Nicole Arbor, if you're watching, I want to say mean things. I want to say angry, hurtful things, but I'm not going to. What I am going to say is this. I encourage you to seek enlightenment. Other people were not put on this planet for your viewing pleasure. We are all human beings. We are all flawed, including you. Because if the stories are true, if even half the stories are true, and I'm sure at least half of the stories are true, sure, I'll accept that there might be a little bit of exaggeration here and there, but if even half of that is true, you are a deeply flawed human being. And I bet inside you seek forgiveness for that. I bet inside you seek to be forgiven for being imperfect. So extend that same courtesy to other people. Forgive and be forgiven. And I'm going to refrain from saying horrible things about you anymore. Just let those negative feelings go. Now, if you are one of those people who liked her video, let's see. I haven't really touched on you yet in this video, so I'm going to say, if you're one of those people who liked that video, look inside of yourself. Is this really progress? Are fat people really not deserving of dignity? Sure, tough love. Some of them are overweight because of their choices, yes. But have you ever walked in those shoes? Have you ever struggled with being overweight in a society that rewards people for being lazy? In a society that rewards people for being shiftless and to manipulate other people into doing physically demanding things for you? In a society that encourages these things, have you ever struggled with weight? If the answer is no, then just take me for my word here. It's not always as easy as you think. It's not. Some people struggle with it. Genetically, we as human beings are genetically wired to hold on to fat, to hold on to sustenance as long as we can. In an era where nutrients were scarce and you didn't know when your next meal was going to be, the human body was designed to not give up that sustenance. And in an era where food is suddenly plentiful, that's a win for man, but nature still takes precedent. And nature says that food is scarce, that you don't know when your next meal is going to be. you have to hold on to that, to those nutrients as long as you can. So there is scientific evidence to show that it's not always as easy as you think. And I'm sure food was more or less scarce depending on where you were. Certain people with certain genetic backgrounds are more likely to be skinny than others, based on where they live. This is science. If you want religious dogma, we were all built differently. We were all designed differently so that we can interact with each other differently. Not everyone is going to be skinny. Now what you, Nicole, did, that was not tough love. That was pure bigoted hatred. I mean, if I was to come into your social circle all of a sudden, how many overweight people would I find that you know? How many overweight friends do you have, Nicole? How many overweight family members do you have? So if you are one of the lowlives who like this video, if I was a Christian man, I'd say I'd pray for you. Just please, find the light. Stop the hate. Be more tolerant of other people. And stop supporting bigots like Nicole. To everybody else, don't let this cause you to lose faith in humanity. This is just what defines a person is how they react to stressful circumstances, and what defines a culture and what defines a species is how they react to things like this. Don't let ignorant people like Nicole bring you down. This is an anomaly. This is one person who is spreading ignorance, and the ignorant people are acknowledging it. Look at the backlash. Look at how many people are outraged over this. Do I agree with her getting her YouTube channel removed, or, you know, whatever form of censorship she suffered? No. I believe in freedom of speech. I don't necessarily believe that YouTube has to protect freedom of speech, but at the same time, I don't think that someone should be... I don't believe that somebody should be censored for just saying things that are unpopular or things that are ignorant. I think people should have the right to spread ignorant things. Doesn't mean everyone else has to like it. But other people have the right to dislike it. And other people have the right to not acknowledge these things. And these people that say these things. Vamanos way. So let's just wrap this up. This represents a low point for the YouTube community. Let's come together. Let's create positive things. Let's not use YouTube as a way to spread hate. And when we do spread hate with YouTube or any other social media, let's use this as an example to move forward. Nicole Arbor, if you're listening, please stop this spiral of self-destruction that you have chosen to go down. I wish you the best. The path you are on now is the wrong path. It is a path of hate. It is a path of ignorance. It is a self-hating, antagonistic path. You are capable of so much better. I encourage you to seek the light. I encourage you to do better. And that's all I'm going to say. This is just too upsetting. I mean, I guess I'm glad I did it, but I'm glad it's over. So, end. Good night, everybody.